For the past year and a half, she has served on the Arcanist Board of Directors as a student representative. In my 10-year experience on the board, we've never had a student rep who's so engaged with our activities and contributed so much to the society. Unfortunately for us, but fortunately for her, Nicole has just received her PhD from the University of Arizona and is actively seeking a position. Whomever hires her will be glad they did. Nicole presented the 3-minute version of this talk last December at our research slam. I was intrigued by that 3 minutes and asked her to expand it into the lecture you will hear tonight on OADM resource use in the Pimeria Alta. Speaking of leaving the board, this will be my last appearance before you as Vice President for Activities. It's been a pleasure to serve in this role for the last 10 years, and I'm confident that Pamela Peltier, who is taking over the position, will continue to bring you great programs. Thank you, and please welcome Nicole.
So you probably all know me from running around doing the equipment for the past year. Thank you for that introduction, Catherine. So today, I'll be talking about my dissertation research, Landscapes of Resilient Autumn Resource Use in the Colonial Pimeria Alta. And when I first came to Tucson, about 6 years ago now, I went to my first Arcanist talk to support a friend, and I was like, one day, I will be here in front of everybody and I will be giving a talk, and that day is today, so I can cross this off my bucket list. I'm very excited to be here and so happy that you all can make it on a sultry June evening. So I always think it's important when we start to tell these kind of stories about the past that we tell everyone here why you should care. Why should we care about anything in the colonial period? Well, the colonial period in this part of the world, in North America, is characterized by the Columbian Exchange. And so the Columbian Exchange was this vast and pervasive transfer of plants, animals, diseases, and people from Eurasia and Africa to the Americas and vice versa. Like, it went both ways. But this movement of people and animals and plants and diseases into parts of the world where they had never been before has created Tucson. So the reason we are here today is because of the processes that began 500 years ago. And so as researchers, as well as descendants of these groups that populated these areas or who had lived in these areas prior to this period, our modern world is very much a product of this process in this time period. And so it's something that we really need to understand because so much of our economy, like, I'll be talking a lot about cattle and sheep, which have been very important to Arizona's economy in the past, as well as the economy of Northern Sonora. So all these processes, the world we live in today, began in this time period. So the area I'll be talking about today is where you're at right now. It's the Pimeria Alta, which is the name the Spanish gave to this area, but is really what was the ancestral heartland for Autumn speakers, as well as several other groups in the area. I'll be focusing on Autumn speaking groups for most of the presentation. And what I would like to kind of underline in this presentation is that the experiences of colonialism were very diverse. They were, the experiences here in the Pimeria Alta and how people interacted are not the same as what happened in New Mexico. It's not the same as what happened in Alta California. It's not the same that happened in Southern Sonora. All these things were kind of colored and shaped by the landscape, the local politics, and relationships of the groups of people who lived here originally, and as well as the desert environment. But this area was the northernmost tip of New Spain, and for that reason, it had a very different kind of trajectory than other areas. But the last thing to remember is that this is a contested landscape. The Spanish really didn't control most of the area. They maybe controlled a few fingers into the river valleys, but much of the area was not colonized. Although, and further north, there really wasn't a lot of Spanish interaction. So what we have here is kind of a very interesting frontier area where there's a lot of contestation, a lot of negotiation, and a lot of room that may not have existed in other areas of the Spanish Empire, which is what really makes this region so interesting. So the time period I'll be talking about today, here's where we are in Tucson. And maybe a few of you have visited Tubac or Tubacacori. You can see that most of the system was south of the border. I'll actually be focusing on the Santa Cruz Basin for the most part. And I'm just gonna keep going backwards, or even. So the story from the European perspective that I'll be talking about is beginning in 1687, when Father Eusebio Aquino, a Jesuit missionary, was assigned to this region. And for the first couple decades, there wasn't a lot of European and Atam interaction. But as time went on, you start seeing more and more miners and ranchers come into the region, secular colonists, Hispanic colonists coming in, and the local peoples who were living at the missions and in other communities their populations began to decline because of European diseases. And so we start seeing this shift happen. But this area continued to be contested with a variety of revolts as well as different kinds of resistance throughout these decades. But by 1767, the Jesuits were expelled and the Franciscans came in. And we see this other half of the 1700s as a period of militarization, increasingly secular government in the area, as well as an influx of Hispanic colonists. And so the end of the colonial period occurred after Mexican independence, when Mexico in 1828 expelled Spanish-born residents, and that included many of the Franciscan priests in the area. So it was under Mexico's control for the next couple decades until it was turned over to the U.S. in 1853. So this is just kind of a basic history of this area, but this is actually quite a very short period of time. And so during all this time, Atam speakers have been living in this area, farming in this area, and making their livelihoods. And so I'm going to use the term Atam in this talk to sort of refer to the many groups, because there were more than one group here, and they are ancestral to the modern Tejana Atam Nation and Akima Atam. And so I'm not trying to collapse that into a single group, but to acknowledge that there's multiple groups, and we don't always have the terminology to describe what was happening, who was living in which communities. So for that reason, I'll be using the word Atam, but I just wanted to clarify that. Okay, so here is the Tejana Atam have not gone away. I think we all know that. They're very much part of the community here in southern Arizona. This is them marching to celebrate the opening of the National Museum of the American Indian, 2004, and sort of part of this big community of fairly recognized Native groups. So one question I was trying to answer with my dissertation, which kind of triggered this whole thing, was I was trying to answer how Atam groups responded to the introduction of livestock. Why should I care about cows? Well, I'm a zooarchaeologist, so that means I study animal bones from archaeological sites. And so I was really interested in how people are adjusting to these animals that require a lot of water, they require a lot of space, and how they're integrating them into their lives. Today, the All Indian Rodeo on the Tejana Atam Nation is one of the biggest celebrations on the reservation. And so this really became an important part both for the economy of Southern Arizona, but for modern groups today. But that also leads to the question, well then how do we study this landscape that these livestock are entering into? And so I kind of wanted to break down me looking at sort of the biotic aspects of a landscape. So this is the ecology, the animals and the plants. There's the abiotic aspects, which include climate and geography and then sort of the terrain people are on. And then there's the cultural aspects of the colonial landscape. And so what we're going to be talking about today are kind of two very different ways of thinking and looking at the environment. But archaeologically, we find sort of these two groups coming together in these communities. And so the cultural is how people are using the landscape and how they're viewing the landscape. So there's variety of things that all go into understanding a colonial landscape. So for most of this research, I was really drawing on post-colonial theory, which is a theoretical tradition which emerged in the 1970s as a way of kind of dealing with this Eurocentric perspective of history that kind of centered everything on Europe. And so that resulted in the exclusion of indigenous experiences and perspectives, as well as sort of excluding the consequences of these histories and these processes on modern indigenous groups. And so post-colonial theory is trying to get at that. And so what I have been drawing on for this research is this idea of persistence and kind of looking at this perspective that that people are not becoming more European by the adoption of livestock or the integration of different practices into their livelihoods, but they are using these sort of tools as a means of survival as well as a persistence of their indigenous identity and their culture. But I also study ecology, I study animals, I study these other things, and so I really also had to draw on a very different theoretical tradition, which is complex adaptive systems. So these are the sort of things, has anyone ever seen stochastic graphs of the ups and downs of the S&P 500 and the different sort of stocks? Well, that's a stochastic graph, and so complex adaptive systems was kind of a theoretical tradition from ecology and computer science that developed to understand, oh, you didn't know there was going to be science, right? You can catch us up. All right. It developed to kind of deal with these sort of graphs that are very chaotic in the short term, but over the long term show distinct patterns. And one of these ideas and concepts from this theory is resilience. And so when I use the term resilience, I'm using it in terms of systemic resilience. And so it's the capacity of a system to absorb disturbance and reorganize while undergoing change so as to still retain essentially the same function, structure, identity, and feedbacks. So this is very different from post-colonial theory, but I found that I've had to kind of use both in order to understand what I've been looking at archaeologically. So an important aspect to resilience is that not everything is resilience. There's a certain point known as a threshold where a system can shift to a new state, right? And so we see these things that up until a certain point here, the system is adapting and trying to deal with outside pressures, but at a certain point, the pressures get too big and the system goes to a different state. So this is something we see in physics, we see it in other parts of the world and experience, but applying it to social systems is a little different. So let's see if I can make the case of what I've been seeing in the Pima Delta. So I'm going to go through three studies. There was a total of four for my dissertation, but decided to cut down a little bit for this talk. But in this first study, I gathered prehistoric and historical zoarchaeological data. So this is these are published reports from the Santa Cruz River Valley. And I wanted to answer the question, how different are Santa Cruz Valley colonial faunal assemblages from previous periods? Because, well, Autochthon groups were living at mission sites, which means that they can't have changed that much from the prehistoric past. So maybe they were continuing to use animals in similar ways. So let's look at and see animal use as a continuum rather than saying that there's a big break in the middle between the prehistoric and the historic. So let's put this data together and see what happens. So I used the number of identified specimens from published assemblages. And then I use the Artiodactyl Index, which kind of looks at the changes in time and the ratio between hoofed animals, so animals with hoofs, and hares and rabbits, so that's that proportion. And then I also use the Shannon Weaver Index, which looks at the diversity and abundance of different animal species. So these are just kind of two different ways of understanding what's happening to animals in this time period. So this is the timeline. So I start at 500 AD, and I go to 1912, which is the end of the territorial period here in Europe. So you can see there's quite a few sites. So this is the Artiodactyl Index. So this is the prehistoric period, and this is the historical period. So this is the colonial through 1912. And you can see that there's a big difference between the two. It's pretty substantial. And so what we really see is that there's this, as this number here approaches one, That means there's an increase in the use of artiodactyls or hooved animals. And so what we really see in the historical period is a lot of livestock. So this is cattle, sheep, goats, horses, the whole gamut. And here, this is, if they're using any hooved animals, it's gonna be deer and pronghorn and bighorn sheep. So that's kind of what we're looking at here. So I argue that this might be a state shift, you know, so we see this big difference in subsistence. And so I wanted to see if the shift in subsistence was actually going to be across the board, or maybe it was something that was actually isolated to animal use. This is the Shannon Index, which looks at diversity, and it's much more spread out, but there's a general trend towards greater diversity, so more species being used in the prehistoric period. But you can see that this it's pretty well spread out for the most part, particularly in the historical period. It goes all over the place, and a lot of this is related to sample size. So the Shannon Index didn't really do much for me. So the summary, what we see here is that colonial animal use, so stuff from the 1780s, is looking way more like something from 1910 than it is 100 years before. During the protohistoric period. So that's something that's very interesting, that whatever was happening in the colonial period set the stage for subsistence patterns for the next 100 years. And livestock are really driving this shift. So their presence in this area really changed how people were using animals, particularly at colonial sites. And so I should make clear that I'm only looking at sites that are colonial sites. It's very actually hard to find at this point in time, sites that are of the same time period that are totally not colonial. So my second study, I expanded a little beyond the Santa Cruz Valley into northern Mexico, and I wanted to answer the question, to what extent seasonal landscape movement take place in Spanish missions? I'm interested in seeing, well, is this only an animal thing, or did the change in landscape use and extend into other things like gathering and seasonal movement? And so the premise of this study is that the missionaries were last to know about stuff. So I went into the Mission 2000 database compiled by National Park Service volunteers, from which they compiled from Spanish archive, and I looked at nine mission sites. And so this is the record of burials and marriages and baptisms from the missions. And so I excluded priests from this estimate and created a couple different graphs, which I hope you will find interesting. So what this blue line here is the sum of the monthly participant count of the folks at the missions. These are the totals for the nine sites. So you can see that in January, there were participants. So for every, so for a baptism, who do you have? You have the parents, you have the godparents, and then you have the person who's being baptized. So those are all participants in these events. And so I summed these participants across the nine sites, and you can see a pattern emerging. And so I first compared this pattern to the precipitation, because I was like, well, there's this big dip in June, in the early June, late May, into October. And it looks like it's happening before the rains come in July and late June. So people are leaving the mission and not participating as frequently in things like baptisms and burials and marriages by the end of May. But you can see a peak here in December around Christmas time. So I actually had the day-to-day frequencies as well, but I have a simplified version here. And then there's another peak here in April. So I looked at this with instead of participation temperature, and what the rise in temperature is kind of corresponding with, it shows a really good negative correlation here with that dip. And so it's looking like a lot of desert foods are ripening at about this time, right? So things like saguaro fruit, mesquite, as well as palo verde, are all kind of ripening around this time. But folks at the mission, Outdone folks know that this is, it's not something you're going to pass up when you have this kind of food. And then after the rains come, you have a situation where you are planting and you have to make sure that the plants are getting in the ground and being monitored all throughout the rainy season. And then there's harvest in late September and October, but you still see this peak. So this seems to correspond pretty well that people are gathering in the winter months. But there's a peak around Christmas, and there's a peak around Easter. And this peak is a little lower because Easter changes depending on the lunar cycle. So in summary, what the study found is that autumn gathering practices continued throughout the colonial period. They didn't stop. This is pretty strong evidence that it was happening throughout the region. And missionaries had a limited influence on subsistence. So even though we see the shift into a lot of livestock at the missions, other aspects of autumn life, such as gathering, continued to happen throughout the mission period. And this was supposed to say, we see an incorporation of Catholic holidays. And so even though we have this kind of traditional movement happening, we see burials and funerals and marriages happening on these major holidays. And so these kind of twofers, and so people are coming together at this time. So the important thing to kind of remember about this data is this is excluding the sort of festivals, like the Festival of San Juan, which is going to be happening later this weekend. But for the most part, those aren't popping up, actually. So marriages, funerals, and burials, baptisms are not being associated with those saints' days. So that's another kind of interesting aspect to take away. So for my third study that I wanted to talk to you about today is I started looking at stable isotopes in livestock tea. And so with this study, I was very interested in the question, what resources were most affected by livestock? And so with stable isotopes, we can actually get at what the animals were eating and what the animals were drinking. And so my data for this comes from isotopic assays of carbon and oxygen from livestock tea from two presidios and one mission site. So to kind of explain what this is, there's kind of two principles to keep in mind when I'm talking about isotopes. The first is that the carbon isotope ratio is kind of divided between C3 grasses and C3 plants, which have a ratio of negative 26 on average, and C4 grasses, which cluster right here, around negative 12.5. And animals that eat grass and like livestock and they eat other plants will be in between here. Sometimes they'll eat more C3 plants and more C4 plants. And so we can kind of see where this is going. And here in the southwest, in this particular area, most of the C4 grasses are associated with semi-desert grasslands. And C4 grasses are associated primarily with sort of wet and hot summer months. And so those are primarily when those C4 grasses are growing. So the other aspect to remember is oxygen isotopes. So oxygen 18 is the heavier isotope, and as water evaporates, the lighter oxygen isotope, oxygen 18, will preferentially evaporate. So it'll, because it's lighter, it'll float up faster than the heavier one. And so bodies of water that are sitting there evaporating will actually become more enriched in the heavier isotope over time. So these are the two kind of things to keep in mind as I present this data. These data, it's plural. Okay, so here for the most part are the cattle, and here for the most part are the, I'm using the term capri, which refers to sheep and goats, because when you have an isolated tooth, it's kind of hard to tell which species it belongs to. That's an identification issue, but that's what this term is referring to. So here on the bottom is the carbon, and here at the top is, on the side here, on the y-axis, is the oxygen ratios. And so what we see here is that, for the most part, the cattle are grouping right around this 12.5 range, which indicates more C4 plants, right? So remember this peak here. On the other end of things, you know, towards more negative 26, we see the caprines, the sheep and the goats, eating more C3 plants. And so that's important. Trust me, it's important. it's important for both ages. It's right here we have a good indication that the cattle are primarily coming and eating from the grasslands and the semi-desert grasslands, while the sheep are having kind of a different diet. But this also holds true with water sources as well. And so here, one of the other things I did in the study was to take modern water samples. And here's the Tucson precipitation average, so it's around -7. Modern water from the Santa Cruz River also groups in this area. From an evaporated cattle pond, we have a -1. But all of these animals are way above that. Some of it is probably due to a little bit to leaf transpiration. So leaves, the plants will also change the isotope ratio of the water. But these animals have to drink every day. So they get most of their water, their body water, from the environment. And so these animals actually show good reflection of the water that they're putting into their bodies. And so it's very clear from this that the cattle have access to slightly fresher water sources or a different water source at all three of these sites. So these are three different sites in the Tucson Basin and in Mojave, which is just north of Nogales. And the Capreans have a slightly different water source, and they're drinking slightly more evaporated water. So this is good evidence for water storage, as well as cattle really impacting, or potentially impacting, the semi-desert grasslands in this area. So these are all kind of looking at, okay, so what does this mean in terms of landscape? So in summary, water, stored water is an important resource for livestock. So a herd of cattle about the size of 200, which is what Wabavis was in 1766, they would go through a good kind of a small pool size of water per day, particularly in the summer months when, you know, that water was more important. Cattle, for the most part, favored C4 grasses. But Capreans ate an equal mix of C3 and C4 plants. And so we see this kind of difference in range management from the get-go. And so this is all happening relatively early in the mission period. Here is a sample of one of the teeth that we sampled all the way down. So we did bulk sampling, which goes down the course of the tooth. So what this represents right here is a year in the life of the animal. So this is what the whole tooth was developing over the course of a year. That's what we're looking at. So in order to kind of bring this together, I'm going to talk about what this meant in terms of how people responded, not only to livestock, but to other aspects of the colonial period and colonial pressures in this area. So to kind of bring it back, what were the Spanish missionaries and soldiers and colonists trying to do in this area? They were trying to turn Autan groups into Spanish peasants, or something akin to that. They wanted to bring these people into this global system and to use their labor in order to extract things that they wanted from this area, which includes mining products, livestock products, as well as eventually what they had hoped as tax-paying citizens of the Spanish Empire. So these are all kind of part of their goals. The Autan have their own practices and had them in the past, and continued. And so what we see in this period is both reorganization and this ability to absorb new pressures. So first, we see sort of reorganization. So this is not people becoming more European-like. I could stop right now and I could eat Thai food for the rest of my life, but that will not make me a Thai person. I come from a different culture, I have a different perspective on things, I think differently and I speak a different language. What I eat is not equivalent to my cultural background. And so I think that's important, that the adoption of livestock did not make someone less Autan. Okay. So the incorporation of Catholic calendars occurred in the gathering cycle. We see this increase in artiodactyl use, specifically among livestock. We see this shift in water resources. We see water storing for livestock. So we also have a very long tradition of water management and irrigation, and as do the Spanish. And so it's unclear here whose traditions they were really drawing from, but I'm curious to know more about that in the future and explore that. And livestock became an important part of life as in the colonial period, and that continued into the 19th century as the Mexicans took over, and then later the US. But at the same time that all these other things and subsistence aspects are shifting, certain things stay the same, and these communities were able to absorb these pressures. And so they continued gathering practices and farming. many of their traditional crops. They appropriated animal husbandry into indigenous culture. And so what we see in the ethnographic record is this celebrations are associated with killing a cow or the head of cattle, a head of a bird asado or something. That becomes a very important part of gathering together and being together as a family. And you also see this kind of shift in the name for a hunting leader becomes the name for ranch cattle herder leader. And so we see also kind of these kind of linguistic shifts, and as the culture kind of begins to absorb these new changes. And for the most part, I don't see a lot of evidence that cattle were actually eating from the crops for the most part, although this may be a possibility with some of the C4 plants, because corn is a C4 plant, so this is going to require some further investigation. So to kind of put it together, I want to make the point that persistence is not the same as systemic resilience. These are two kind of very different theoretical traditions, and the persistence of a group of people and their identity and their practices and their cohesion as a group and their leadership is not necessarily the same as systemic resilience. So although we do see this big shift in hunting and animal use from the historic period, from the prehistoric into the mission and colonial period, that does not undermine the persistence of Autan culture and group cohesion. Local conditions shaped Autan colonial experiences with livestock. And so sort of kind of the availability of semi-desert grasslands influenced how they were able to move and adapt livestock to this landscape. Their responses were multifaceted and seasonal. And so, you know, you can see that from the mission data, we see these shifts in where people are on the landscape over time as they adjust and incorporate both the demands of Catholic traditions into, as well as their gathering traditions. We also see diverse methodologies needed for landscape level understandings of colonialism. So we need to know all the, and if I only told you the animal part of the story, that would give you a very different perspective than from the gathering data from the missions. And so when we see these kind of differences, we need multi-level methodologies and different kinds of ways of looking at the same problem in order to understand the impacts of colonialism. So what's next? So my goal here in the future is to really kind of connect these data into new connections between, into people's lives. So really bring in ethnography, potentially collaboration, that's in the infancy for me, but to also expand isotope studies into new sites and to introduce serial sampling into these sites. So that means going almost kind of month by month down the tooth to really see how this is changing and how where the animals are eating over time. And to also see what's happening in Sonora, because this is really, here in the Santa Cruz Valley, this is just one part of the story. And so a lot of that's happening south of the border, and so it'll be very interesting in the future to see what's gonna happen there. Like to acknowledge all these amazing people that got me to this point, and to thank you all for sitting through my talk, much appreciated. Yes.
Yeah, I'm more familiar with California than I am here, but one of the things that really struck me, I loved your graphics showing precipitation and temperature and engagement with the missions. In California, I realized that it's a very different tradition in terms of recruitment. But in California, folks tended to leave the missions during times of drought, mm-hmm. times of food stress. And it seems to be just the exact opposite here in Southern Arizona, where people are less engaged with the missions in time of food abundance. Do you want to talk mm-hmm. a little bit about that in terms of recruitment? And to me, that's just fascinating.
Yeah. So this is an average over about 120 years. So this is not, so this data is not necessarily showing the sort of periods of drought. This is incorporating periods of drought into it because it's just taking what's available from the mission censuses. And so in the California case, you have very different kind of rhythms, which also sometimes include gathering of marine resources. But this action was actually inspired by Sim Schneider from Northern California and his study of looking at shellfish in the North Bay area and how he used mission records to show people continuing to go back to shell mounds even during the colonial period. But it's these absences which are the key thing. And so this fact that people are not here, they're not doing these activities associated with the mission during some key times of year, but they're coming back when a lot of the sort of plant growth has slowed down in the winter time. And that's why perhaps they can incorporate, you know, the sort of holidays of Easter and Christmas, because they're not necessarily corresponding. But the weird thing is that you don't see winter wheat. I don't know, are you guys any familiar with winter wheat? So winter wheat is a European introduction, and it spread like wildfire throughout the Piura Alta and beyond the colonial influenced areas. So this is the northernmost point. People were growing it in the Phoenix Basin, because it was just, it filled this really important time of lead time in the year. So these are kind of hungry months. So that might actually be one of the things that maybe this graph is incorporating the benefits of winter wheat into it. But that's kind of a difference. But I think what's really cool about the California case is you could still use this with the absences.
Yep.
Yes, ma'am.
It would be helpful on that slide if you could label the three colors. You aren't really telling us what they are, are you?
It got cut off. So I do have it, but it got cut off. So, sorry. Yeah, so this is the average highs, average lows, and then this here. And for some reason that got on and that didn't. Yes, sir.
It's my impression that in other areas, particularly like I'm thinking of the Northern Rio Grande, the Spanish had a much, hegemony almost had a much greater transformational impact on Puebloans than the Onondaga. Do you think that's right? And if so, how come?
I would disagree with that. I think there's one historian has recently kind of published a book about the Pueblification of the Spanish and kind of looking at it from the perspective that the Spanish adjusted and changed to the Pueblo in that area. But the kind of initiation into colonialism from New Mexico was a secular invasion. It was, you know, the priests were kind of an afterthought. This is almost completely led by religious missionaries. And so that way, it was much slower. This land was, it was kind of a harder area to sell people on. And there were a lot of raiding. There was a lot of raiding happening. So I think what was interesting about this area is that we see these landscape transformations, but I wouldn't argue that it's less than those areas. I just think we probably haven't done some of the soil studies, or I haven't looked at that yet. That's actually the next step, is looking at the pollen and the botanicals and the soil studies to kind of see how these are all different facets of these landscape changes. So that's, I would say it's, you know, how the invasion occurred in each area and how people were organized politically, that's going to be shaping how the landscape was being used. Yes, sir.
What sites might you use in Sonora?
Mm-hmm. That's a good question. Let me get back to that big old map, because there's so many. I'm still working on it. It's, so you can see here, there's Cocospora, which is abandoned, but many of these places are still in use. I don't know. I was on the Archipelago board, but I'm also on the Southwest Mission Research Center board. We actually run trips down to Sonora, so if anyone's interested, let me know. But to go visit these missions, but many of them are still in use, from Imari, Sintubutama, Okitoa, and Itiquito, Magdalena, San Ignacio, all these places are places, because often speakers were on both sides of the border. So these processes are playing out in both places. So any of these areas here would be just sort of great opportunities. We do have archaeological material from Cocospora and Dolores, but for the most part, they have not been excavated, which makes it both very exciting, but also kind of difficult, because it is a different culture. They have different cultural resource laws, and I'm still getting into it. So that's kind of where I'm looking to next, to expand this study. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I'm curious. My understanding was that the did not own most of the domestic animals in the early colonial period. Did the consumption of domestic animals go up over time?
So it's really kind of tough to say, because when we, so this is why I use a kind of a systemic definition and complex adaptive systems to kind of understand this, because these colonial sites were places where it's majority opt-in living, but we don't really completely know how their labor was being used and how much control of their labor they had. So even though we're finding all this livestock, it's not entirely clear how much control they had over those activities, if they were forced or if that had been a negotiated thing. So for that reason, we use kind of the term labor to kind of describe what's happening. But mission herds were technically owned in common, right? So this was a communal ownership. So you can kind of think of these, and the missionary administered them and made a lot of the decisions, but for the most part, they're communally owned and could be sold primarily by the priests, but that's how they were kind of understood, is that this belonged to everyone in the, who lived in the mission community. So that's kind of how that worked, but they could still be bought and sold, but the money would go to the missionary.
One more quick question, really stupid. Is there genetic differences that show up in the skeletal remains of these domestic animals and modern cow, cattle, etc.?
Yeah, so the question was about the genetic differences between that kind of colonial period cattle and modern cattle. So for the most part, what we're seeing here are criollo breeds. So they're kind of desert adapted. They sort of were bred over time in northern Mexico and moved north in what we call kind of the cattle frontier of Spanish expansion. And so they're kind of the ancestral herds that you find in New Mexico, in Texas, even in Florida, in California. And in fact, it was herds from Sonora that ended up populating many of the missions in Alta California. So this is a species that they're very small, they're very rangy. So they're still Bos taurus as a species, but you could do the genetic differences between them. And so there's a project now on the East Coast looking at genetic differences between heritage varieties of cattle. We have not done that yet here because since they're all kind of one breed, the differences are not quite there yet, but there's a lot of possibility in the future, particularly in the American period, because that's when we see British breeds, these fat, heavy cows that require a lot of water, that are not really desert adapted. They need help giving birth. Criollos don't. They can kind of go out on their own. And for that reason, they're kind of a very interesting to see that difference at what time that influx comes in to Arizona and when that's happening. So we could explore that genetically, but for the most part, the genetics are not a question that's going to really help us in the colonial period. But that's something very curious about, particularly in the late 19th century. Yeah. All right. I think you guys are all sticking through that.